Hello, I'm Aki Vehtari, and this is a video clip for Bayesian data analysis course on topic Introduction to Decision Making, Uncertainty and Modeling. You can find more material available at the website Zone. I'll start with the telling about the importance of quantifying uncertainties in case of decision making. This figure is from some time ago when there was a tornado Irma approaching Florida. And there are these very good weather forecast models which can predict the route of the tornado. You can see in the figure the black line showing the most probable route. But there's also possible to have uncertainty about this route shown by gray color. And now this, knowing the uncertainty, it's very important in making a decision which cities to evacuate. Although there's cost in evacuating a city, there's also cost if the tornado hits some city as people can die. And then if the probability of a tornado hitting some city is high enough, it is better to evacuate it even if eventually then the tornado does not hit all these cities which had been evacuated. So in this video clip, I'll talk about two types of uncertainty, aleatoric and epistemic, a little bit about representing uncertainty with probabilities and how to update uncertainties, and there's more than in the later clips about this. So there are two types of uncertainty, aleatoric uncertainty due to randomness and epistemic uncertainty due to lack of knowledge. I have here Eurocoin. It has number one and Euro map of Europe on one side, and other side is the Leonardo da Vinci man. But I will say heads or tails, as is usual in English. If I flip this coin, I will get heads or tails. And if I repeat, I would assume that you would agree that there's a 50-50 chance that I get heads or tails. And this is just a random process each time, and it doesn't change how many times I flip it. And we are not able to obtain observations or additional information which could reduce this uncertainty. It's every time just a 50-50 chance. On the other hand, I can choose which side I put up in my hand. There's no randomness anymore. It has certain state. I know which side is up. You don't know, and so you have lack of knowledge, and this can be represented as epistemic uncertainty. It's also possible then that this can change if I show this coin to someone, their knowledge will change, their epistemic uncertainty will change, and they will know which side is up. So we are able to obtain observations which can reduce this uncertainty. Also, two observers may have different epistemic uncertainty. Those who have seen which side is up have a different uncertainty than those who have not yet seen which side is up. In this case of this coin, it's quite simple, just the 50-50 all the time, whether I'm flipping it or choosing it. But I exclude a bit more complex case. I have here a pack of chips. I have there yellow and red chips. And I can show you this size, red one. And if I would tell you how many red ones and yellow ones there are, you could then compute the probability that what is the color of the next chip I get up by computing this ratio of reds to total number. And we now denote it with letter theta. And then in this case, if I would have half red and half yellow, it would be exactly as the coin. If I would have less reds, it would be the probability would be just something different, but otherwise it would be the same, that we would have this aleatoric randomness, aleatoric uncertainty about the color of the next tip. And so we can use this mathematical notation P for the probability. The probability that the Y is red, Y being the next color of the tip, and the bar denoting conditionally of theta, where the theta is now that probability we computed based on knowing the number of red and yellow ones. And this would then tell us this aleatoric uncertainty. But I did not tell you how many red and yellow ones there are. So we have epistemic uncertainty about theta. And we can then use, again, P and then theta to denote that this is now the probability distribution for what would be, how likely we think different values of theta are. Now, if I keep picking up a chip, put it back, and again, I get red, yellow, red, and so on. If I would keep picking up more often red ones, then I would assume that you can agree that it's more likely that there are more reds than yellows if I more often pick up these reds. So that means that even if I don't tell you how many red and yellows are, by repeatedly sewing one, putting it back, randomly picking another one, you are learning something about the ratio of red and yellow ones. And now we can then write the probability of theta, the ratio, given Y, and then the sequence of the observations. And then how do we compute this? Then it happens to be the Bayes rule. I've come back to Bayes rule more later. But you can see here in the Bayes rule, we had here the aleatoric uncertainty part, PY given theta, it's here. We have the epistemic uncertainty about the theta, it's here. We have something which is called normalization term, and then we get out what we wanted to know. What is the uncertainty about the ratio given the observations? And we'll come to many examples of this later. At this point, I quickly mention that so often we can drop out the normalization term, and then we use the proportional sign. And then it is also useful to notice that this same PY bar theta, it has two different meanings, whether it's a function of Y. So when we were telling about that it's a model telling how likely the next tip is red, is a function of the next observation, and then assuming that we know the ratio, or the same notation can also mean likelihood. So after we've observed something, what if we vary theta, how likely different theta values are, and we learn something about the epistemic uncertainty. And then the Bayes rule combines now this likelihood with prior uncertainty, and then we get the updated posterior uncertainty. This example of chips from the back is quite simple. There's a bit more complex example. This is time series prediction. This could be something predicting number of users coming to a website, a number of customers coming to a store, and so on. In this case, it's RStan software downloads per day from RStudio CRAN Mirror. You see the black dots are the raw data. This model fitted to the data, the blue line, and I can also zoom closer. So this is starting from beginning of last July. And you can see it is the blue line is kind of going close to the black dots. And it's also predicting in the future. So we have now a bit more complex model than just one theta predicting color of the chip. Now we have a prediction how many downloads there would be in the future. And you can see that it is a bit more complex models because in the future there's also, you can see this jumpy pattern. And there the blue, light blue is showing the uncertainty. So we can also quantify the uncertainty, which could be then useful, for example, in a store, how many products we need to be available for the customers or how many customer service people needs to be there available. This, the blue line, you can see that there's a lot of structure in there. And in this case, this is the model has different components. This specifically, this model was made with Prophet software package, which is built on top of Stan, which I talk more and which you learn during the course. The first part, there's a trend, overall trend in, you can see during the years that there's more and more downloads per day. There's holidays. Actually, these are release dates, so that when there's a release date, some users download more quickly. And you can see that the difference is in percentages, so there's relative to this trend. There's a weekly pattern, so there's less downloads during weekends. And there's a yearly pattern, which reflects a bit of different holidays, but also it reflects quite much of academic teaching terms, as this R-Stan is also used a lot in teaching. So when we have different data analysis problems, different phenomena to model, we need to formulate what we know in mathematical form. So we need to formulate these, our epistemic uncertainties, possible structural knowledge, and those parts we can describe also using distributions, these aleatory randomness parts. So we describe what we know and what we don't know in mathematical form. After we form these distributions, it's easy part is to use Bayes' rule to update uncertainties. Easy is in quotations because there's a computational challenge. So it's easy to write the mathematical equation for the update. It's more difficult to then compute something which is useful for making decisions. There are then other parts we go through during this course, like model checking, is data in conflict with our prior knowledge, presentation, how we present the model and results to application experts, and so on. Bit more about what does the model mean and why it is important to remember what the model means. Think about that we would be dropping a ball from different heights, and we would measure time it takes to drop to the floor. We would get a ladder and we would drop it from higher. And we could collect the how the height and time to hit the floor, how they are related to each other. We could possibly see the kind of the Newtonian mechanics you learn in high school, at how the ball accelerates due to gravity, and based on that, how much time it takes to hit. But then, maybe we need to take also into account the air resistance. You know that if you drop air balloon, it will drop much more slowly than if you drop metal ball. whether air pressure affects shape, surface structure of the ball, and so on. For dropping objects, satellites are kind of dropping all the time, but they just at the same time go so fast that they all the time also miss the Earth. In case of satellites, GPS satellites, we need to take into account also relativity, but definitely we don't need to take into account if we would be dropping balls just in this room. We know that the relativity is actually more accurate model for dropping objects, but it's also, if we are measuring these times, even just with the hand stopwatch, it is more complex model than what we need. So it is important to remember that simpler models can still be very useful to make predictions. Newton's mechanics has been very good predicting planetary motions for a very long time before it was noticed that in some cases relativity is also needed. So taking into account the accuracy of the measurements, how accurate model is needed, and then that's why we often manage with quite simple models being able to do something useful. There's also the saying George P. Box says, all models are wrong, but some of them are useful, meaning that the model itself, it means really that it's not the actual nature. It's a model of the nature, but you can still, with these models, learn something useful or predict some useful. Here's an example of different modeling examples from StanCon 2018, organized in Helsinki in last August. And you can pause the video to read more of these, but you can see the kind of the big variety of different fields, the Bayesian data analysis is used. So in this clip, I talked about two types of uncertainty, aleatoric and epistemic. A little bit about using probabilities and updating uncertainty, and more about those later. And then in the end, there's a question you can discuss also with your friends. Or next time when we meet, you can answer this to me. What is your own example with both aleatoric and epistemic uncertainty? So I had the example of bag of chips, and you can now think about your own example. See you.